So I always begin with this one. So happy birthday, Giacomo Barozzi da Vignola. He was born on the 1st of October. His name was actually Giacomo Barozzi, but he was born in Vignola, little town or village, whatever, in Italy. But he is known as Vignola, mainly, you know. Very few people use all his long name, and it is rather long, Giacomo Barozzi da Vignola. You can call him Vignola. Born on the 1st of October, 1507. And who is Vignola? Let's see. First, let's look at how he looked like. Well, you know, we don't know when this engraving or etching was made. Probably later. Usually these engravers take or took poetical licenses, and they often idealized the portrait of someone, or it was not. They didn't have photography at that time. And anyway, in this engraving, he looks good. You know, he looks like a serious man, and he doesn't have a wig. Well, at that time, wigs were not used like in the Baroque times. Well, here is another one, you know, because if you were famous, and you see he has an architectural instrument in his right hand, and he does stare at us with that, architect's, gaze, so to speak. Anyway. So he was one of the great Italian architects of 16th century mannerism. His two great masterpieces are the Villa Farnese at Caprarola and the Jesuits Church of the Gesù in Rome. The three architects who spread the Italian Renaissance style throughout Western Europe are Vignola, Serlio, and Palladio. Now, I don't know, I mean, you know, you can choose other architects, but yes, Vignola and Serlio, they also published, you know, theoretical work. So did Palladio, but Palladio also built a lot and built brilliantly. Anyway, so remember this again, the three architects who spread the Italian Renaissance style, although he was towards the end, that's why he was associated with mannerism through Western Europe, were Vignola, Sebastiano Serlio, and Andrea Palladio. Some drawings by Mr. Vignola. This is not going to be a very large presentation. Maybe I was influenced by Le Corbusier, and I kind of began to dislike Vignola myself, although probably unjustly. He was a didactician. In his drawings and the pages of his advocating a certain reality, a certain architecture, he was didactic. Maybe this irritated Le Corbusier, that he was too didactic, and it's true. He did influence the teaching of architecture, the education in architecture. And he still does. He's still mentioned highly. But I will end this presentation with a page from Le Poème de Longue Le Droit by Le Corbusier, where you'll see what, in a very non-academic way, Le Corbusier addresses Monsieur Vignola, Mr. Vignola. Anyway, pages with a lot of scholastic, measurements and. He essentially drew a manual of how to build using the classical orders mainly. Maybe this in itself was enough reason for Le Corbusier to protest. But for a good number of centuries, people build like this based on this manual. Because it's very clearly drawn, and you just pick up. It's kind of a Neufert, of that time, except that here my main concerns were of an aesthetical nature. They didn't yet have refrigerators and the paraphernalia of gadgets that we have, so they didn't have a need for what we call today functionalism, really. Yesterday, I read on Arch Daily that now is questioned even the living room as a functional, plausible, desirable entity in an apartment or in a house today. And I really welcome and I like this fact that there are already articles questioning even the validity or the necessity of something which appears so, you know, unavoidable, like the living room. You know, any project in any school, you know, prescribes to you what to do, how big the living room is, but what is the living room? And Arch Daily legitimately asked, well, maybe there is a difference between the living room and the family room. And I invite to reflection, especially students, to this, because we take it as some kind of unavoidable a must of any apartment, any house, the so-called living room. You know, but what is the living room actually? You know, in villages in Romania, you didn't have living rooms. You had kitchen and you had a room for guests, the guest room. That's different, very different. But there was no living room. Apparently, those people didn't need a so-called living room. Anyway, it's an interesting subject. Do we need living rooms, so-called living rooms, or not? Because, you know, to call a room a living room as if in the other rooms there is no living is a little bit, provocative. You know, what are you trying to say? That in the kitchen there is no living? In the bedrooms there is no living? Just in the so-called living room that the living takes place? It's absurd. Anyway, back to Mr. Vignola. Now we arrive at Villa Giulia for Pope Julius III in Rome from 1550 to 1553. Palladio, I remind you, died in 1580. So this building was built when Palladio was alive and doing well. He was about 40 something years. I think he died at 73 or 72. Here Vignola, many architects died at 72. Here Vignola was working with Amanati, who designed the Nymphaeum and other garden features under the general direction of Vasari. Vasari, who built the Uffizi, which are now galleries in Florence, which are so well known, with guidance from the knowledgeable Pope and Michelangelo himself. A medal of 1553 shows Vignola's main villa substantially as it was completed, save for a pair of cupolas. And here it is. But because of the involvement of so many people, it's hard to know what exactly he did. Look what is here. Well, what did Vignola do? I'm sure the experts know. I don't. I'm not an expert. I just try to stir up things, the curiosity of anyone who wants to know more about Vignola, and to, yes, say happy birthday to him, even if maybe I would have provoked the sarcasm of Le Corbusier, and I will try to explain a little bit later why. This villa, I don't know. I mean, there are many interesting buildings, villas or not, and I don't know. Plus, it's hard to know if indeed, I mean, he was not the sole author of this building, Vignola. Sorry about alarm being spread everywhere. They are masters of destroying their own pictures, and they usually have very nice pictures, but in the name of so-called, authorship, they destroy their own pictures. Welcome to artistic capitalism, if I can call it so. So Vignola, Villa Giulia, but not just him, as I just read, Amanati, even Michelangelo was there, some other people. Late Renaissance, in what is called today mannerism. But this Nymphaeum was done by Amanati, and this is interesting, was not done by Vignola, but I like this part of this villa. You know, especially the bottom, which has some vegetation there as well. Anyway, Villa Giulia. Of course, it has sculptures here and there, something we forget to even think about. Why should we have sculptures in alcoves in our buildings, right? Why? Well, they thought differently. And they thought at the time, not much later from, you know, it's possible that at the time when Vignola was active, the Neoplatonic Academy in Florence was still alive. But, you know, anyway. Villa Farnese at Caprarola from 1559 to 1573, another, you know, important building, is like a fortress almost. I mean, with many windows, but it's so, you know, enclosed, so self-centered in a way. We are going to look at it, you know, it's yeah, you know, someone would say it's a powerful building, but yeah, it might be so-called powerful, but power without grace is not sufficient. And anyway, he did this, the Farnese. I'm sure that I was influenced by the iconoclasm of Le Corbusier vis-à-vis Vignola, because somehow he made me have very, I don't know, I don't have the usual affection that I commonly have about important architects. Somewhere in the back of my mind, Le Corbusier's words towards Vignola resonate. Anyway, look at the plan. It is like a citadel in a way. It happens that I like citadels, but this citadel is a private citadel, you know. It's not a citadel is supposed to be a mini city that is for many people. Well, many, you know, a number of people, but not for, you know, a single family or something like this. But this one seems to be, it is for one single patron, you know. It's just, it's a private citadel. But I don't know if this infuriated Le Corbusier or not. We'll try to estimate towards the end. And again, this is not a very large presentation, but we do our duty to remember Vignola on the day when he was born. And he was born on the 1st of October, as opposed to Bjarke Ingels, who was born on the 2nd of October. Here it is. What can we say? Another glorious building in Italy. I mean, almost any building in Italy is glorious and designed by a genius. Perfect symmetry, of course. Even the gardens are, you know, rigidly designed and drawn and you know, implemented. Otherwise, the blue sky, if we make abstraction of 1, 2, 3 RF, is as blue as in other places and as beautiful, probably. What is nice about the buildings, perhaps outside of the building, you know, these constructions that are at the periphery in a way, that are fragmented and they are connected with the exterior, with the gardens, and these I like. But the fortress itself, I don't know. Look at the interior. It's almost like if it didn't have the large arches, you would say it's almost like a prison. I mean, also considering its you know, imposition on the landscape because of its you know, demanding silhouette and perfect symmetry. Otherwise, manneristic accents do appear, like this staircase, you know, because the spiral is already problematizes the certitudes and the self-centeredness of the building as a whole. But again, Vignola had a great prestige, academic prestige, you know, because of his manuals, you know, that I guess Le Corbusier was irritated by the, but who knows, sometimes the mystics say that, not just the mystics, well, the mystics say that when we do not see things as they are, we see things as we are. And Carl Jung said something not very different, that's when something infuriates us outside of us, is because something within us is reflected back to us from what we, from what infuriates us. So it's possible, who knows? It's possible that Le Corbusier had a certain vignola in himself. Otherwise, why would he be so irritated? But he was also irritated by the donkey, the poor animal. And I will talk about it in 5 days on his birthday when we'll have a mini festival, Le Corbusier, 6 or 8 hours nonstop. Yes, I hope I can carry it to completion. I want to pay homage to Le Corbusier in a grand way, so to speak. So 6 or 8 hours nonstop, the 6th of October, Le Corbusier. A mini festival. Back to Vignola and his spiralic staircase is fine. It's fine, you know. And plus, you know, even if it wasn't so fine, because of all the artworks, the frescoes on the walls, you know, this is the role maybe of painting, of frescoes. They soften the. I mean, architecture is part of a whole, where it plays an important part, but it's not alone. So thus, you know, even if the construction itself or the building itself, or the, in this case, the staircase itself architecturally is not great, because of the many distracting, you know, images around it, the image is less easily, you know, to be accused of who knows what imperfections. Anyway, I'm a little bit tired of this building. We saw this staircase, again, Vignola, Villa Giulia, and he made this one by himself. So here he has no excuse of any sort that if something didn't work was because of someone else. Another view of the same glorious staircase. But again, why is it that those people, you know, like, 450 years ago, approximately, had such a need to cover everything on the wall, every surface with images, with custom made for that particular wall. What we do, we hang on our white or not so white walls, little pictures or larger pictures, but they created these frescoes for those specific walls. You couldn't take off that fresco and put it somewhere else. It's also true that this was not a building for a nobody. Was a building for a somebody. That somebody who could commission Vignola to do this building was probably a big somebody, so to speak. This, by the way, of the fact that I wrote the text for a possible architectural competition, a house for a nobody. How would make one a house? First of all, it's an insult to anyone, you know, to think of anyone as being a nobody. No one is a nobody, and no one truly is a somebody. You know, Napoleon, who died 200 years ago, he became a nobody because he died alone and miserable at 52 in exile on the island Elba. So even the great emperor, right? So in the end, you know, we are born to die. We become dust again. So who is a somebody and who is a nobody? But I do like the presence of these statues, you know, that, and, you know, when I think of the many sculptors and painters and artists that we do have, and they have nothing to work and they have no means even to survive, you know, many of them, and we don't employ their talent. It's, I think, unacceptable, actually. Look at this. If you remove the frescoes, you get much less. But the frescoes, they create a unity with the whole, you know, with the construction. It's a humanized interior that has some grace exactly because of the participation of the artist, but this participation shouldn't happen like in the case of postmodernism, where it became a joke of itself almost. The last architect we'll talk about this October will be Charles Moore, who was a kind of an interesting postmodern. I usually am very turned off by postmodernism, Charles Moore had some interesting works. Anyway, I don't want to anticipate more than I did. The 31st of October, besides being the birthday of Zaha Hadid, it's also the birthday of Charles Moore. I don't know if I can talk about both on the same day. Villa Lante at Baniaia, 1566 onwards, including the gardens, the water features and casino. You know, I can breathe again because I see gardens, I see water, I see statues, and I think we need more of them. The more, the better. And that's why I keep saying, I think we need more gardeners than architects in today's world. And that's why the University of Cincinnati, and probably there are others, they have a department of horticulture within the School of Architecture. This, I think, is great. I think this should be done also in the schools of architecture in our country. Yeah, to have a small department, at least, if not a faculty in itself, you know, gardening, you know, horticulture. Because we need the green badly, unless we enjoy our suffocations, our beautiful pollution. So, look at the gardens, you know. I mean, there are two buildings here, just two little buildings. Oh, yeah, I think these are the ones, not these. I'm a little bit confused because, yeah, these are the two buildings. And look at the garden, you know. And I think, what if we design today through or by starting with the gardens? We don't start. Usually, if we do a garden at all or a little park, we do them after we build the buildings. But what if we start the other way around? Start with the garden, not with the building, and then make the building to match the garden, not the other way around. I think it would be interesting. And I would also say necessary. Yes, in the section is clear. These are the buildings. There are two identical buildings, or almost identical. You see, towards the outside, they are identical. But inside, the distribution of rooms is a little bit different. Anyway, there are two buildings, two brothers, if I am to think of a building by John Haydock in Berlin. And this is the garden, and also here, you know, I mean, there is much more garden or park, because this is not just a typical garden. Anyway, these are the buildings, you see them here. What can we say, you know, there are two grayish cubes, but what saves them actually is the exterior space, and you know, the water and the sculptures and the trees behind and so on, and all these things humanize the buildings, which are otherwise, I don't know if they are so impressive. They are rather morose, actually. But again, the garden park or the park garden saves the whole thing. And then the fountain, and we need more fountains as well in our cities. This is my belief. We don't have enough of them. I imagine we could even have abstract statues, you know, today. We could, and it would be very interesting to see here, I don't know, Malevich inspired sculpture or, yeah, why not? Usually, I mean, in some cases, like the buildings of Mies van der Rohe have in Chicago, you know, a sculpture by Alexander Calder, mobile or not. Yes, because when the building is too perfectly, you know, functionalist, there is a need for some rebellion, for some rebellious gesture. And that's where the artist is needed. The artist brings in that otherness without which life is difficult, I would say. Anyway, this is a more recent rendering. So these are the two buildings and, you know, the garden, you know, late Renaissance, Mannerist garden, I guess Vignola was employed also for the design of the exterior spaces to some extent. And bravo to him. I don't think this is so bad. And actually, if you turn this whole drawing 90 degrees to the left, you almost see the silhouette of a human being with the head here and the shoulders. And yes, the part of the body from the knees down is missing or so, but otherwise. Could we say that maybe the solar plexus would be here? I don't know. Maybe we shouldn't go so far and analyzing this site plan in terms of how we would analyze the plan of Chartres Cathedral, where there are indeed the speculations about all kinds of sophisticated aspects of the plan. Now, the Chiesa del Gesù of Jesus in Rome, the mother church of the Jesuit order, which would become a source for Baroque church facades in the 17th century. Yes. So the mother, finally a mother. Well, in the case of a church, it should be indeed a mother, not a father. And this building, I think, is good. The facade, which was done by Vignola. He didn't design the cars in front of it, but you have to excuse the modern Italy, which is so obsessed by cars and shoes. Andrei Tarkovsky in his film Nostalgia was quite right at one moment where, a drunk poet, a Russian, who came to Italy to discover, to see a painting by Piero della Francesca hidden in a church. And at one moment, he tells a little girl not far away from him, he was asking himself, why so many shoes? And it's true, you go to Venice, there are shoes in every storefront window almost, countless shoes, shoes and shoes and shoes and shoes. Maybe David Bowie was right, when in an interview he said in the United States, he said, culture itself maybe is not needed, because why shouldn't we be happy just with, having one plate? Why do we need 100 kinds of plates? Just one plate where we eat. And but he was subverting his own cause, of course, because he was a musician, David Bowie. So, but I kind of understand, all this. But then, is a plate or a pair of shoes part of culture? In a way, no. But in a way, maybe yes. It depends what we understand by culture. I don't think they should belong to culture, the shoes. But anyway, forget the shoes, forget the plates. Although the plates, amazingly, they could resist in time more than the pyramids. Yes. You just bury the most fragile, plate at a certain depth in the earth, and it will survive for thousands of years there, while the pyramid will be eroded by the elements, and so on. So that's why actually some of the earliest artifacts found are plates. The most fragile, and again, it's almost like a paradox. A plate endures more, survives for a longer time than a pyramid. That is the power of the weak. So weak, W-E-A-K. Welcome to Lao Tzu and his beautiful, beautiful, beautiful philosophy of the weak in praise of what we call the weak. I mean, even the women were considered for centuries, if not thousands of years, the so-called weak sex. You know this very well. That's how men describe women. But Napoleon knew better. He Napoleon, whose 200 years since his death happens this year, said the only victory in front of a woman is to run away. So who is the weak one here and who is the powerful one? All the powerful men are the truly powerful men, like Napoleon or Nietzsche even, understood the unbelievable force of women. So the same with a plate. Appears to be fragile, But in actually, as I said, it endures, it survives for a longer time than the pyramid. Anyway, sorry about this digression. I don't know. It has nothing to do with the elevation, the facade by the arch enemy of Le Corbusier. Well, Le Corbusier was the arch enemy of Vignola. But this facade is fine, Mr. Le Corbusier. I'm sorry. I actually like it. It's pre-Baroque, but it's well. I think it's well designed, and it has a certain complexity, a certain dignity. I think it's good. Maybe in this light, a little bit less. No, but even in this light, no. It is a good facade. By Vignola, of course, chiesa dedicata al nome di Gesù, di padre. Yes, anyway, it's a Jesuit church in Rome, the mother of all following Baroque churches, and Rome had beautiful, as you know, Baroque movement. It wasn't just Bernini, and it wasn't just Borromini. It was also Pietro da Cortona. My God, what beautiful architects, name them as you want. The interior also is beautiful, but I don't think it was done by him, by Vignola. But we are in the building whose main facade elevation was done by Vignola. And you wonder, you know, what inspired these people towards this kind of work? Because, you know, this is a lifetime work, you know, to just imagine, you know, climbing there, you know, and doing that work on that ceiling, which is also curved. And look at the complexity, you know, it's amazing. But these people, I guess they believed in God. They truly believed in God, and they dedicated their lives. They didn't have TVs, okay? They didn't have what we have. So they didn't stare at HBO movies all day or all night. They created this. Well, maybe, you know, the modus vivendi is not something to remain without some inspirational effects on us, hopefully, maybe. Moving forward, this is the plan. Yes, you enter the church at west, as you are supposed to, and you move towards the altar, which is supposed to be at east, even if it's not perfectly at east, but it's fine. It's God is forgiving small deviations from the rigid dogma. Why did they paint the ceiling like this? Because, you know, the ceiling, I mean, it was the skin in a way of the building, vertically speaking. The ceiling announced the heaven above. It was an anticipation, in a way, a prefiguration of the heavens. So it had to be exalted and exalting. It had to. Look what's going on there. Now, again, this was not done by Vignola, but is in the building, in the church, whose main facade was designed by Vignola. I don't know who was the artist who worked here, but we have to acknowledge it. There is some work here, you know, and not just, I mean, it's incredible in a way, you know, it really is. I wonder what the minimalists say, you know, what would the minimalists say, you know, this is nonsense. I would rather have a building, bare building with right angles and easily traced with, you know, a T-square and a rectangle. We don't need this madness. But those people at the time thought differently. You know, they would not have given any kind of attention to the banality of our so-called modern minimalist buildings. No. They were different species, really, a different kind of humans. They were different. Very different. Look at this. The human drama about which the minimalist doesn't whisper a word, doesn't say anything. The minimalist and the functionalist doesn't say anything about the human drama. No, no, it's all a rectangle, you know, a simple prism, and that's it. That's all we can do, you know. No, not this, something like this, you know. Anyway, I like this though. I miss the Baroque, it's true. Basilica of Santa Maria degli Angeli. I'm beginning to like Italian. I so regret I don't know Italian. In Assisi, with Galeazzo Alessi, Basilica of Santa Maria degli Angeli. Yeah, maybe we need more angels in the world. In a few days, it will be the birthday. No, I'm wrong. Next year, it will be an important year, either birth or when he died of the great, I don't know how to describe him, philosopher, astrologer, alchemist, Swedenborg, Swedish, who said, quoted by Daniel Lipskin, that the more angels in the sky, the more space. A very interesting statement, really. I mean, think about it. If we populate heavens or the sky with as many angels as possible, Swedenborg thought that there will be more space. And Daniel Lipskin, when he quoted Swedenborg, I guess he agreed with Swedenborg. And I would agree with Lipskin and implicitly with Swedenborg. The more angels, if we crowd the whole sky with angels, there will be more space, actually. Why? Because there will be more spirit in the world. But we don't care about angels. We descended from the monkey, thanks to Charles Darwin. And this nonsense with angels is just nonsense. Science can dismiss immediately, you know, through some, calculations, even the possibility of having an angel in the world. No. But Ingmar Bergman, the greatest, again, Swedish film director and a great creator, he believed in spirits. He thought that there are actually spirits, you know, in the air. and he was a very modern man, and yet interesting, no? Anyway, Santa Maria degli Angeli, progettata da, interestingly, that Galeazzo Alessi, his name appears before Jacopo Barozzi da Vignola, who only had interventions. This is also interesting. So it's actually only in part Vignola's work. Maybe Vignola was living parasitically somehow on the shoulders of other creators. This is often done in architecture, actually. Some people do the work and other people get the fame. It's very common, actually. Anyway, Church of Sant'Andrea in Via Flaminia in Rome, the first church to have an oval dome, which became a signature of the Baroque. Now, this building I really like because it's some kind of I appeared just minutes ago to be against minimalism, but this building is kind of both Baroque and minimalist. Look at this. You know, I think Claude Nicolas Ledoux would have loved it too. It's a very nice building. If this would have been a perfect cylinder, meaning based on a circle, would have been less impressive, but it's actually an ellipse, you know, in plan. It's not a circle. So this is a mannerist, choice, I would say. Otherwise the building is, almost cerebral, almost austere, almost neoclassical. It makes me even think a little bit about the public library by Gunnar Asplund in Stockholm. I like this building. I really do. I don't even know if Le Corbusier knew of it. And I'm almost sure Claude Nicolas Ledoux would have loved it. But, you know, the so-called classicist, facade part of it, it's okay. But I don't know, it's almost modern also. So Vignola was not so bad as Monsieur Le Corbusier seemed to think. And you understand why at the end, because I don't actually. Here are some, also what's nice about this, that you enter the church directly into the only space, actually, the main space. It's kind of interesting, a small church, but somehow architecturally engaging. And apparently it was famous, because we see here, even in old engravings, you know, Chiesa di Sant'Andrea Apostolo, Posta Favori, Fuori della Porta del Popolo, Architettura Jacopo Barozzi di da Vignola. Vignola being the town or the city, not the city, the town, I guess, or the village where Jacopo Barozzi was born. The interior also is almost modern, you know, it's very you know, simple, so to speak. Even the ceiling, you know, I mean, this is telling the truth about the truth of the plan, that is not based on a circle. It's an ellipse, which has two circles, two centers. And this is kind of interesting. Yeah, it's not bad, I would say. I like this building. Now, Palazzo dei Bianchi, the Banchi in Bologna. Now, this is something very different. Here is a building that is, you know, part of the city, a majestic part. It's a, you know, a palazzo in a way. But I don't know for whom it was built. Palazzo dei Banchi. I guess that's the family, Banchi. Maybe any linguistic resemblance to the word having to do with a bank is just a coincidence. I don't know. But this building also, I would say it's a decent architecture for considering the time when it was built. It's not, you know, it's not amazingly, you know, attracting our attention, but it does the job. And I guess he designed alone this palazzo. We are approaching the end of this otherwise short presentation of Vignola. For 2 or 3 or 4 years or 5 even, I avoided his name. I didn't want to talk about Vignola because I was influenced by Le Corbusier's opinion about him. And the last image of this presentation will be with that page from Le Corbusier. I don't know who designed the church on the right, which is indeed monumental and domineering. It's okay. I don't know. I mean, you know, just another building, I guess. This time by Jacopo Barozzi da Vignola. Strange though, maybe this is a mannerism. I'm not very sure how to describe this, but look at these tiny windows. And then larger windows, you know, but these tiny windows here are indeed very strange. You know, I don't know. They are a little bit peculiar in my opinion. Well, mannerism has usually so-called strange things, you know, okay, now we go to the Palazzo Farnese in Piacenza. This was a grandiose project of a vast palace on a scale paralleled only by the Vatican Palace in Italy. The rectangular plan is circa is approximately 111 meters by 88 meters. The actual construction, however, made up only less than a half of Vignola's original project and lacked many of the planned architectural features. Missing elements include part of the exterior, surrounding walls, the main facade modeled on the ancient triumphal arch and with a large tower, a theater in the large inner courtyard. Again, a fortress. We have seen previously another villa by Vignola that was fortress-like. This one also, you know, it's not a building that is willing to make any compromises with whatever might be in the exterior. No, it's I like though these parts, which are probably some of them fragmented, but the building in its main facade is crushing. Really, it's very difficult to be in its shadow. Again, I like what's in the back, but here we are dealing with authority. Here we are dealing with, almost a warning. Do not approach us. Do not come even close, please. There are many bad dogs here, do not approach us. Maybe the misanthropic side of Vignola is shown there. Maybe he was a misanthrope. I don't know. Again, a lot of little windows. Maybe they were not so small considering the huge scale of the building, if it was second only to the Vatican buildings, but I don't know. Anyway, the interior is human because the interior had to be human because people lived there. The artists came in and the sculptors and so on. Now, I end this rather imperfect and short presentation on this architect with this page from Le Corbusier, from Le Poème de l'Angle le Droit, where he attacks, I read in other places, his malicious attacks on Vignola. Le Corbusier was mad at Vignola for some reason, and I don't know why. I'm not an expert really in Le Corbusier, but I never came across an explanation where the hatred of Vignola came from. But you'll see the funny language he uses in this last slide, if I am to call it so, of this presentation. It's here. So there are actually two, but these are from the Le Poème de l'Angle le Droit. On the right, you see the trajectory, the apparent trajectory of the sun at summer solstice and winter solstice, the summer solstice being this one and the winter solstice being this one. But what is intriguing, so to speak, is the wording, also the rather enticing figure he drew here, but what he wrote: J'espère sous ce titre la maison fille du soleil, et Vignole enfin est foutu. Merci, victoire. This was written by Charles Edouard Jeanneret, alias Le Corbusier. So let's think a little bit. He claims, the house has to be the daughter of the sun. Okay, we could say this, but why the funny attack on Vignola? Because the last word of this line is almost identical in Romanian. E Vignol, enfin, after some trials and errors or some, failed attempts or so. Anyway, e Vignola, enfin, Vignol, enfin, est foutu. Merci, victoire. Now, Le Poème de l'Angle le Droit is a later work, a graphic work by Le Corbusier, which is, alchemical in nature. Apparently, and this really took me by surprise, Le Corbusier had some interest later in his life in, some esotericism in a way, in alchemical matters. This I didn't know. And it's true, it's a little difficult, it's very cryptic, this work, Le Poème de l'Angle le Droit. So with this I end this short trip in the work of Vignola. If Le Corbusier was right about him or not, I cannot tell. If indeed he achieved a certain victory and there was reason for saying merci, victoire, I don't know again. So happy birthday though, Vignola, and please forgive Le Corbusier if you can.